That was, yeah, it was there. There, now there.
There.
Okay. Welcome to the regular planning board meeting for April 2015. Would you all rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Welcome, we have a relatively short agenda tonight.
We have one late addition.
Yeah, there is one late addition to the agenda. There's a town board referral of a zoning amendment to add 2010-22 Main Street Drive in overlay district, recommendation to the town board. That's the last item on the agenda. Need to get a new copy of the agenda up here. First item on the agenda is the Lutheran Care Network. Seek a review and preliminary subdivision site plan and aquatic resource permit hearing. This is going to be adjourned. It's to adjourn to June 18th, 2015. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we adjourn the public hearing for the Lutheran Care Network application to June 18th, 2015. I call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 4-0. The second item on the agenda is also an adjournment. Arlington Farms Malabar Realty LLC site plan public hearing. It's to be adjourned to May 21st, 2015. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we adjourn the public hearing for Arlington Farms site plan public hearing. All those in question? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Okay, the first real item on the agenda tonight is the Golden Corral Restaurant site plan public hearing of a site plan for 11,000 square foot, one-story Golden Corral's restaurant, including parking, grading, stormwater, lighting, utilities, and landscaping, 2345 South Road, zoned BH Business Highway, plus or minus 4.77 acres, unlisted action, 82 Anfran Realty Incorporated owners. Do you have anything you would like to present?
Good evening. My name is Amador LaPut, project manager at Fellinger Engineering, representing Cornucopia Queen Incorporated, Golden Corral franchisee. Also with us is Gary Custer, vice president of Golden Corral. We have in front of you a site plan for the proposed project. Is this mic portable?
Yeah, I might have to turn it.
If you don't mind, I'll stand for this.
Sure, that's fine.
So the existing site, 2345 Route 9. Route 9 is shown here on the right. I'm sorry, sir, if you wanted to see these, I could turn them toward you.
Okay.
We have the previous ownership of this site was, or use, was a florist and a Cars for Cash here along Route 9. Currently, there is a fencing contractor yard here in the middle of the site, and the rest is undeveloped. There's a metal building toward the back here. So looking at the site, we looked at a number of items, including wetlands, floodplain, impact of threatened and endangered species, and we find we are outside of the 100-year floodplain per the FEMA mapping. We have Ecological Solutions. Mike Nowicki has gone through to look at threatened and endangered species as well as state and federal wetlands. He finds no wetlands on any of the properties, state or federal. He does look at the bog turtle, the dwarf mussel, and the northern cottontail, which required no mitigation for our site. He also looked at the Indiana bat and the long-eared bat, which I believe the Indiana has just come off the endangered species list to the threatened species list. Mitigation for the bat species would be to do no tree clearing from April through September, and the applicant agrees to that. The existing site drainage has two major basin areas, one near the front, which will drain towards Route 9, and one near the back, which eventually ends up through this corner of the property here. So our proposed development is the 11,000 square foot Golden Corral here, seating for 400. We have a parking area to support that, which by code requires 114 spaces. We are providing 170. Golden Corral has a number of standardized design features for their restaurants, not only in the architectural design, but for instance, parking lot lighting should be certain levels and parking requirements here, and we are meeting those, which do exceed the town code. So we have a area here. You see the green area in the middle of the parking area for buyer retention. So we're going to handle stormwater in this way. We do exceed the 1 acre disturbance. We're about 2.5 acres of disturbance here, and we will then meet the current New York State Stormwater Management Design Manual, where the post-development flow will meet or be less than the pre-development flow. And one way to do that is with buyer retention. So we're proposing that here and then also in the rear of the parking. So as you see, we propose no development here near the R20 zone and the buffering and landscaping around the parking areas would also be used as buyer retention. Now, we will have site utilities, just showing that we will be using existing water, gas, sewer, and stormwater along Route 9. Details for such. And our lighting plan. We'd like to thank the town. There was a lot of input in developing the location for the restaurant and parking. So the original design was to have the restaurant near the back and the bulk of the parking in the front. So with the town comments, we looked and were able to rearrange this parking so that the restaurant's at the front and the parking is in the back. With the lighting, we originally had proposed higher poles. And with the town suggestion to look at lower poles, we are able to meet Golden Corral's lighting levels with what are 15-foot poles now. So there are more of them, and then we can achieve that lighting level. So we have received comments from the town. We find no serious obstacles to us being able to work through with the consultants. We are open, if the town is, to meet with the consultants and the engineer to go over those items to try to meet the next month's mission.
We are always in favor of having work meetings to resolve those issues. Okay.
So I believe the next submission for us would be a week from Monday, meaning next week we're going to do a lot of work to get this plan ready for you.
Just contact Eric and or Neil, and he'll try to set up whatever to set up to move forward.
Good. So I'll open it up to any questions, unless you'd like me to describe some more of the property.
Do you want to go over your comments, Eric?
Sure. I'm
going to do that and then the public hearing.
Yeah, we'll do the public hearing after that.
You have the staff's comments. There's still some items, there's some secret items outstanding that we recommend be addressed prior to any secret determination by the board. There's a bit of work to be done on the SWIP for the stormwater general permit. The applicant indicated that a full traffic study is still forthcoming. There's a state historic preservation review process to be addressed. And I think that's, those are kind of the larger issues. There's comments by some of the consultants. I will add, I know the traffic consultant said he would review the traffic report when it arrived, and that he would also review the, he also made a couple of other requests, including a truck turning plan. And I'll add to that by recommending that in addition to trucks, I've heard members of the board and others ask about buses, and we know that Golden Corral does tend to receive a lot of buses. So if we could address that in the plan, and perhaps also in any narrative that's forthcoming, a little bit of information for the board about the frequency of bus visitation, which would just be helpful.
Sure. Certainly we will address that. Thank you.
Sure. Otherwise, we had a number of comments on different areas. Not too many planning comments. I guess the lighting, I've talked with Amador. They think they can work with us to achieve a plan that's within the requirements of the lighting code. Most of the other comments were, there's some technical issues to be resolved. Maybe I'll leave that for Joe.
Joe?
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, Amador and I spoke briefly right before the meeting. And as he mentioned, we're going to try to convene a meeting offline to go over some of the technical details of the stormwater. So we'll try to make that happen next week so they can submit the following week. Other than stormwater, I mean, there were some items with the grading plan that needed a little more detail. Utilities seem to be fairly well conceived, but I think part of the meeting, maybe we can bring in the water and sewer department and let them provide input to some of the utilities as well. And having Rich Pearson reviewing the truck turns and the traffic, I think that would help, and getting some input from the DOT to learn what their requirements are going to be. I know there was mention of the sidewalk maintenance agreements. But I think what they submitted so far is a pretty good start on the plan. It's just, and they said, you know, they'll work with us on addressing the various details.
Okay. Question, Joe.
Yeah.
There's an awful lot of truck maintenance and garages in the back there. Is there any concern for the soils back there in that regard?
Yeah, that is a good point, although I don't know if Amador would speak to if they did any kind of soil testing or any kind of environmental review of the property recently.
Our firm has not done any soil testing, but Ms. Henderson is here, and I believe the environmental site assessment has been done for you.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
So we could provide that to the board with our submission.
Yeah, I just think it would be, for your sake as well, make sure that the soils are not been disturbed from an oil gasoline standpoint or things like that.
Correct. Okay, we will provide that report.
All right, thank you.
Okay, anything else, Joe?
No.
This is a public hearing. Do I hear a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. We open the public hearing. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes 4-0. Nobody signed up, but is there anybody in the audience that would like to comment on this application?
A question, Eric. Is it the designer's responsibility or the owner to notify those residents within a certain number of feet of the site that there is a public hearing?
The department does that.
It does. Did mm-hmm. we do it?
We had some phone calls from residents.
Okay. All right.
I believe it's 200 feet from the boundary of the
That's
property.
What I thought I remembered.
Right.
There was some confusion about who was doing it these days. Okay. Thank you.
Since we don't seem to have any comments, do I hear a motion to adjourn the public hearing to June or May 21st?
So moved.
Second.
So moved and seconded that we adjourn the public hearing to May 21st, 2015. Call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Any comments from the board? We'll start with, since you already started, Ed.
Aye. I only had a couple of things that the zoning administrator has already brought up. That would be the landscaping. She's suggesting 100-foot design criteria of the lot that size. And the other thing, most of it's been covered already. Parking, I guess, is okay. The bus has been mentioned. The only other thing I would want to make sure that's attention that's brought to is any odors. You are dealing with a residential community there, and even though nobody showed up or anything, that would be a concern that I would have if I was a resident. So I'd like to make sure that you've got proper snuffers and sniffers and all that kind of stuff installed so that that doesn't become a problem. Other than that, fine. Glad to see the site get used.
Lynn?
Thank you. Comment?
Carl?
Yeah, I have a few. Appreciate you did away with the parking in front there, and I think that's an opportunity to do some more landscaping in front there as well. And that,
thank you.
That all works well together. I think that positions your restaurant also out of sight of the auto body a little more as well from the way it's working. I think, where was I going to, from the parking standpoint, I got a couple questions about parking because, you know, the county mentioned that you're 59 spaces over the code. Is there, and I think it all ties in, is there a consideration perhaps of maybe land banking those 35 spaces that are near the apartments so you have a little more of a buffer there initially? Or does your business model really think you need that much parking?
It is the standard business model for Golden Corral, and at this time we would ask to use the 170 they were proposing.
Is there any? I've heard Golden Corral sometimes get bus traffic. Is there any consideration for bus parking at this site?
We're going to be considering that. We're right now showing only car parking there, so we're going to adjust that in the next submission.
Okay, and. All right, they're all kind of tied together. I think Eric had a comment on it also, but or somebody did, about making sure there's a crosswalk marked, you know, from the parking area across where the driving lane is to get tie in with the sidewalk around the restaurant. Just so people, the cars coming in, know there could be people crossing there.
Right, could be crossing. Yeah, we'll note that on the next plan.
A little safety issue. I had a question on the signage. Are you planning a monument sign or a pole sign, and where exactly would that be up front?
I haven't discussed that with the applicant yet. Gary, would like to address that?
Yeah, Gary Custer, I didn't sign in, but I will. We would plan on a pedestal sign, and it would be right near the entrance. We haven't determined that yet. We usually have a sign company do a boom test, but okay. My guess is it would be somewhere in this area right here.
Okay.
But it would be whatever. Mm-hmm. We'd make sure we were in compliance with whatever the regulations are.
Okay, make sure, it doesn't block the line of sight traffic and things like that.
And as far as the parking lot, the 170, when that store opens, every parking space will be used. We would really need to have the full 170.
Sure.
That will not even be enough parking at times. I mean, so we'll need every parking spot that we can get. And 170 is our minimum. We usually do 190, 100, 200. We have a lot of stores with 200 parking spaces. So
okay,
so 170 is
it's above our code. So that I had to ask the question.
It's a busy restaurant.
That's good for your business. Hopefully. I guess the only other question I had about was, did you explore at all? We talked last time about any connectivity to the hotel site. It's fairly flat topography there, but you're not showing any.
Correct. Yeah, we haven't shown that yet.
If you explored that yet or not.
We'll be discussing that more with the consultants and the applicant.
Okay.
Decide what's the best way to show that.
I mean, that's kind of a swale, I guess, you got going on with around the area. For does that help with bioretention as well? On the
correct.
Outside of the parking.
Yeah, we have a number of bioretentions. It kind of borders the whole parking area. Mm-hmm. will be used as buyer retention. And then toward the back, parking going towards the R20 will be a larger area for buyer retention as well. And we're going to be handling up to the 100-year storm with that.
I think that's all my comments now. Thanks.
We had one other just question concerning, we're trying to get, you know, with the hotels next door and so forth, sidewalks there, you know, along Route 9 to allow for pedestrian traffic. I see what appears to be a little brown strips there in front. Is that sidewalks, or is that that's something we need to address one way or another?
So the strips along Route 9 are sidewalks?
I don't know. I'm just wondering what's on your...
Oh, sorry. They are sidewalks.
Okay.
So we're showing those. Yeah, they're kind of a different gray here.
Mm-hmm.
And then the crosswalk across, and then continuing through
Okay.
our site
Good.
There. And then sidewalk to the building. So we'll talk about, you know, trying to connect to the
hotels. That's what I was wondering, connection either.
Are we thinking about the apartments as well?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So we haven't shown that yet, but we're
okay.
certainly
Okay, I mean, that's, you just want to make sure that's addressed.
I mean, that road that goes to, from the apartments parking, you know, pathway to the apartment is shown there, but it's really pretty flat land right there to come
okay.
across into your
At
parking lot.
At the end
lot.
Of their parking lot is pretty
it's
flat?
Right.
Yeah.
And similar on the other, say, behind the hotel there. The more connectivity you have, the better to get customers in and out, having people from the hotel going out onto Route 9 and back in again, perhaps.
You can make it a yellow brick road.
Golden brick road.
Even if you only decide maybe a pedestrian connection versus vehicular or something.
So. Yeah, we were only talking pedestrian connection.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other discussion from the board? Do you want to make any comment? I see you just have brought it
in. Yeah, I want to thank Ryan Fellinger for bringing up the architectural rendering. So just to give you an idea, they're typical Golden Corral restaurant. So the color is the height and the width are typical for that restaurant we're proposing.
So what would be the Route 9 facing side?
So this side faces into the parking. Route 9 will be here. So the side would be?
Just in the upper right there.
This one here.
It's going to be one of the ends.
The other one, I would guess. Well, maybe not.
So, the side with the entrance.
Side right here.
Sorry. That
it's a reverse.
Yeah, I see the buffet and grill, but that's not the entrance. So that side would be facing Route 9.
Okay.
That would be the Route 9 facing
right here.
Side.
This is the main entrance.
I didn't think you wanted the back of the building showing out through Route 9.
No, yeah, this mimics the front, so I thought that was the
yeah.
front
good,
entrance.
Good.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And we will do an architectural review when we do the site plan.
Yes, we'll be submitting elevations with this next submission.
And, you know, materials and colors.
Okay. The other thing to watch out for is to make... I was just going to mention the HVAC to make sure that's hidden, if you have anything on the roof.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, we got parapets that will hide the roof-mounted equipment. When you talk about samples and colors, are we talking about physical samples or just...
physical things, samples.
Okay.
Excuse me, Rich, I thought of one other thing mm-hmm. that the board should be aware of. What they're currently showing is... part of it is because they're doing bioretention and they want the parking lot run up to sheet into the bioretention area. They don't have curbing over most of that parking area. So they're relying a lot on wheel stops instead of actual curb. I just wanted the board to be aware of that because I think the town has preferred curbing.
Like this year.
Yeah, that's one of the problems with all the wheel stops. It makes snow removal more difficult and... You know, they get knocked around and they kind of get in the way of cars and people walking when they're not in the right place. So
mm-hmm.
I've just thought about curbing or notch. We've seen them, you know, people have done more of a notched curb or they just have what they call leak-offs at key low points rather than doing away with the curb altogether.
Right. Yeah, we'll consider that. Just have the curb, you know, 20-foot sections, and then the
also,
drop to.
As he just kind of brought up, a snow, where would you stack the snow if it was this year? Need a good piling area.
It's a good piling area. So we've left the outside of the parking areas. We look at how to merge landscape and snow storage in the same space.
Amador, just as a thought, one solution we've seen in places where curb stops are problematic is we've sometimes seen people use timber guide rails.
Okay.
Because they provide a visual marker as well as a physical marker, but they allow water flow.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Any other discussion? What's the pleasure of the board?
I'll make a motion that the planning board defer action site plan application and direct the applicant to respond to comments received, including but not limited to those as follows, 1 through 12. And I've just added curbing, snow storage, and bus parking. Is there anything else?
The pedestrian connectivity.
The sidewalk and pedestrian continuity.
And just the other comments that in the record.
And all the other comments.
They will be shown in our response.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the planning board defer action on the site plan application and direct the application to respond to the comments received, including but not limited to those below, 1 through 12.
And we got curbing, snow storage, bus parking, sidewalks, and pedestrian.
And any other comments from the discussion at the board? It's been moved and seconded. I call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 4-0. So hopefully we'll have some discussions over the next couple of weeks, and we'll see you again in May.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Would the public hearing be held open, or could that
be we've adjourned it, so it'll be reopened at the next meeting. Okay. We're looking forward to this. I mean, I've heard nothing but good comments about Golden Corral.
Good.
And I know a number
spread
of people have been there and had good experiences there, so. And we would like to see, you know, Route 9 cleaned up, and this will be a good addition.
You'll be a good spokesman.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda that was the only site plan. So at this time, I will ask for a motion to suspend the rules to allow comments on any other items tonight's agenda. Your comments will not be part of the record on any of the application's referrals or items that are on the agenda for discussion.
So moved.
Second.
We moved and seconded that we suspend the rules to allow comments on the other agenda items. Is there anybody here that would care to comment on the other items on the agenda? Do I hear a motion to resume the rules?
So moved.
Second.
We moved and seconded that we resume the rules. Next item on the agenda is Oakwood Friends School Solar City site plan. Planning board to declare lead agency intent and site plan review for a proposed installation of a ground-mounted racking solar array system on the 2.56 acres, 22 Spatenkill Road, zoned IN institutional, 52 acres, unlisted action, Oakwood private school owner. Introduce yourselves and make any presentation you can.
Good evening. Ken Casamento from LRC, representing the applicant.
And Rob Miller from Solar City.
Tom? So this, I don't know if everyone's familiar where Oakwood School is, right off Spatenkill Road by Route 9. As you enter into the front entrance of the school, there's a area off to the left.
That Ken, is your microphone turned on?
You have to hold it up
close
to your mouth.
That's the
day from the last time I went to.
There we go.
This area here was historically a field in the 1970s, 1990s, and roughly 2000. There was a site work that was done to the soccer fields to create the second soccer field and do some site grading. And some of that material was placed here. and hence the difference in contours, the mound, and some of the filling area that was done. So this area has historically been a field and then overgrown since roughly the 2000, somewhere in there. The project area is about 3.7 acres. It's a little bigger than what's in your current document, because what we've done with Solar City, as we were since our last submission, the racking systems that they use typically can follow the terrain, and to minimize the site work, we wanted to follow the topography as close to possible to meet the maximum minimum requirements for the racking system. But what we found when we did the performance models, actually Solar City, was we had some shading of the panels that would reduce the efficiency of the panels. So we wanted to create more of a linear slope so it's even across the site. So it's almost the same project area, and the project area is increased due to the comments, some of the comments as well, showing where we've done trees. The disturbed area is still only approximately 2.19 acres. But it's creating a more of an even slope from front to back of the site, reworking of the materials, no site work coming off site or on, just reworking of the material that's already in this area. We've looked at the wetlands. There is a wetland here that historically was the ice skating rink of the school that has remained that way for a long time at this point, and it's become a wetland. It's under the 1 acre threshold, so it's a non-regulated wetland, as Carol Knapp pointed out, as well as Mike Nowicki, who did the wetland analysis. The trees and habitat here were identified as not something that we had to do any mitigation for the threatened the bats. We received today, and I have copies for you, Carol, a sign-off from SHPO on the State Historic Preservation. So there's 8 or 9 copies there, I believe, if you need more. So SHPO has signed off as not having a problem with the project. The way the racking system works is it's actually a 6-inch post that is driven 12 to 16 feet in length across the array. That's the only impact to the ground are the posts every 12 to 16 feet. And then at the end of the arrays, we have a trench where the utilities connect each array together. So there's very little actual ground dirt disturbance. Most of it is temporary. Hard surface is really, in this case, it's 0.01 acres of hard surface impact because of the posts at the ground surface. So that's really it in a nutshell.
Which way are you facing? Southwest or south directly? Or
there, it's going to be facing almost directly south.
Okay.
They're right here.
Non-movable, right?
Correct. Correct. They're fixed mounted. If you look, this is a very similar system. This is one that was done at Millbrook Schools. They're fixed mounted. They're set on an angle based off of the topography and the angle of the sun for the most efficiency in the patterns.
Do you have any comments, sir?
Yeah. For tonight, the only action recommended to the board is to circulate for lead agency. We did generate some comments in order to expedite review. We did generate our own comments and obtain the comments of various departments and consultants to help the project move along. We did probably the most significant comment. You have them in front of you, and I think the applicant does as well. Probably the largest issue is the one of screening, in particular from the residential neighborhood located to the east, and how that's going to change. I guess mostly, you know, we could talk about it some tonight, but what would be helpful for the next submittal also is what we were recommending would be that some cross sections and visuals so that the board is able, so that we can document and for the board to see how it's going to what extent it will be visible.
Okay.
To the extent that visuals may or may not be able to portray this, we're also, it's not in here, but we're recommending the board, I know, may want to stop by on the site itself and see to what extent it's able to see the houses, because if you can see them one way, then you can probably see them the other way. And
if
that
I
will
may
provide
for
a guide.
On that, Eric,
sure.
If you don't mind, because one thing I forgot to mention is there's a utility line that comes through here that feeds Oakwood now for some of the buildings back here. So part of this is helping maintain that line that's there, because they go in there and they have power outages with the trees that fall on top of it. So there's been discussions already with the neighbors, and actually some of the discussions have been, can you help take some of our trees down on the line? Yes. So there's been that discussion in here. It's thinning of more of the taller trees, not really taking the understory down, just for a point of clarification. But yes, Eric, we'll obviously sit and meet with you and talk through that.
Sure. Also, our comment number two, due to a question raised previously by a board member, we're recommending that the SES regulations of 210-67.1, we would add subparagraph B to that list. So it would be 210-67.1 parentheses B parentheses E2 and F. B has to do with the with the extent to which the facility, the purposes of the solar energy mm-hmm. system regulations addresses the extent to which the facility serves the needs of the landowner. And that question has been raised by the planning board, so we've incorporated that into our recommendation. Otherwise, there are some seeker issues outstanding here. Also, we received a threatened and endangered species report just last Friday.
Mm-hmm.
So I haven't reviewed that,
okay.
that yet. We'll have to do that for the next time around. And thank you. I'm looking forward to reading the state historic preservation process. A couple of minor things and some updates to the EAF in here and information on the plan. Those are our comments.
Joe, do you have any comments?
Yes. I did walk the site briefly with Ken and another school representative just to get a feel for the property location. And we were able to walk to the opposite side, and I saw some of the backs of the houses or the neighbors that Ken mentioned. And it does seem like, you know, it's already an area that's been disturbed some by the utility line that's there. So... and he's already had some meetings, evidently, with them. So, but in terms of stormwater, they put together a erosion sediment control plan, and they are seeking somewhat, it's an exemption, but it's allowed for in the permit. With this being a utility project, they're proposing that rather than doing anything with a real permanent stormwater mitigation, they're basically looking at sediment and erosion control measures, and it seems to be an allowed exemption in the permit. But I did ask Ken to just kind of look at the effect that they're having on the existing ground cover and the terrain, just to make sure there's not going to be any real concentration of runoff or any erosion. And he's going to give us some more details about that. Then we had some other comments about the just clarifying the limits of work and the grading, and Ken mentioned too he's done some further revision of the grading plan due to their solar efficiency, but it sounds like it makes sense. Some of the other comments are just, you know, clarifications or, you know, providing more details on notes. And we had some comments here at the end about they were saying deferring these over to the building department, but they had to do with electrical details and grounding, just some things that we noticed that we thought when the building permit application comes through, they should probably be looked at for more mainly for safety issues. So I think that's pretty much everything.
When we did... had our discussion at the field trip, there was some question concerning taxes relating to this, since this is a for-profit project and a non-profit.
We don't have an answer to that question yet, but I know the tax assessor, we've talked about it with the tax assessor, and she is researching it, since residential facilities, according to the state, for residential facilities, it's calculated one way with no... The state recognizes the value of the improvements without taxing it. She's now consulting with them to determine how that relates to circumstances such as this one.
Okay. Take comments from the board, Ben.
So, I guess from you guys just said what we understand. This is solely for the purpose of the school.
Correct.
Not for any other. Just for power for the school.
Correct.
Not for any municipal public.
Nope. It's what they call a power purchase agreement. Is what they're doing. So they're only allowed to generate enough power that the school already consumes that has been calculated. So they're not allowed to create more power than what's being consumed.
Okay.
Am I correct in that?
Yeah, it's called a virtual net meter. So there is a connection to the grid, and the power does go to the grid, but the school retains all the credits for that electricity generated, and those are applied to only the school's accounts. Okay. So it's not connected directly to the school equipment, but by what they call virtual net meter, it's a virtual. They get the credits applied to their bills.
Only the school can get the credit.
So it would appear to not be a for profit.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah.
It is not intended for any of that.
Okay.
That's it. That's my only comment.
Carl.
I guess I'll just follow up. Yeah, that meets the intent of our town code, which says the said facility
correct.
Should be. For the principal use of the property it's on. I was just curious offhand if you knew what percentage of the school's power that would cover then, or?
I don't know what percentage.
About 100%.
Oh, 100%. Okay. Right. So that'd be pretty good for the school then.
Right. That is why they're looking to move forward with it.
Yeah, I don't know if it was could it cover half theirs or something, but that's good. Close to off the grid, so to speak. I didn't know if I saw it on the map, but I when I was out there walking, I did see the cleared utility, and I guess they have an easement there for the utility. Or
it is owned by the school, and that's okay. Part of the comment of the trees. And I'll just turn this back on.
I mean, there was no trees in the utility corridor itself.
Yes, the trees in the utility corridor, as you can see a little more clearly out here, are solely the responsibility of Oakwood.
Okay.
They're not Central Hudson poles. So
okay.
Oakwood is continually out here trying to, and they
so
don't have the
so
manpower.
They
don't have the manpower that Central Hudson does to keep the lines down. So
yep.
Unfortunately, they have more interruptions. So this is also helping that.
It seemed pretty clear when I was out there the other day. And what's left, I guess, is mostly taller trees and some pricker underbrush kind of
right.
stuff, which mostly go away, I guess. And so from a standpoint of the neighbors would, and all that is mostly deciduous that's there now.
Right.
So I don't know if you're planning for screening some evergreen trees or what.
We haven't at the moment because no one from the neighbors has been concerned about it. We are planning on having another conversation with the neighbors.
Okay.
Should something like that come out, we'll be happy to put it on the plans. Or
another concern for the neighbors, is there any lighting proposed here that might
there is no lighting proposed
at night or something?
Correct. There's
okay.
no lighting proposed.
Terrific.
Not even safety?
No, there's no one's there, so it's just the fence around it, and it's a private secure
area.
But it's a secured area, so that's to keep kids in and out, or out, I should say.
Oh. Basically, I saw an 8-foot chain link fence on
correct.
The plans.
Correct.
Okay.
Along the lines of the fence to keep the kids out, somebody at one point noted that there are electrical facilities for the project located outside the fence. Does that make sense?
We've actually talked about moving them in. There's a panel here.
Mm-hmm.
It was set up for basically in the future if the school ever needed to gain a location for power
mm-hmm.
that would be here. That was the reason it was outside the fence, but we've since brought it in the fence so it's secured in the area.
Okay.
The reason there was also a question from Sarah, I believe, about the gate and the backside, the man gate here, is again, there'll be maintenance from Oakwood, so they wanted another access in for just being able to get in and out access. That's all it was.
I guess my last question I had, curious about the what you're planting there. What's the undergrowth? Is it, I assume grass is going to have to be mowed all the time, and that would be troublesome between all the arrays? Or
It goes to what actually Joe was talking about with stormwater as well. Currently, this is half open soil and half kind of...
It's kind of a mess. So.
Yes. As you've seen, the intent is to... typically, we plant a low-mow grass, which the panel sits 2 feet off in the front, so the grass can come up about 2 feet, and then they go in and maintain it. It's also dependent on the aesthetic of what the school wants to mow, how often they want to mow it, but that is once it hits the 2 foot where it would block some of the array, and that's when we would actually go in and mow it other than that.
Hmm. And who's responsible for that?
It'd be the school's responsibility to maintain it in this case.
You know, we looked up something about solar farms with regard to the regulation, and in England, apparently, it's very popular to literally make them solar farms and to keep the sheeps and the goats.
Yeah,
let them do the mowing.
It makes sense.
We've done that. Yes.
Helps with the mowing.
At least you don't have to worry about the birds. You have any other comments, Ed? Are you still working,
Derek?
I guess anything. How does this work for snow and snow removal? And
it actually comes off with the angle for the most part. As the panel exposes itself from just the natural slope that the panel has, it generates heat when the solar panel hits it.
Yeah.
So it'll start to generate enough heat to just give it enough of a form to slide off.
Slides off anyway.
Correct.
It's got its own defroster.
Absolutely.
That's what I thought. I just wanted to check.
Yep.
Okay, thanks.
A few questions. Did I understand you to say then that this 75 kVA transformer you get down at the bottom, is that going to be enclosed inside the fence now or not?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yep.
Good. I got a couple of safety concerns regarding my own kids having played soccer there and going into that weed pile trying to find the balls. Your fencing is only going to be 8 feet high. I can guarantee you there'll be soccer balls in there. I would suggest you consider a higher fence, for one. And number two, if the balls are in there, how are you going to keep the kids out going for that ball? I know you got it's fenced off and so on and so forth, but I've seen kids go over fences that I couldn't believe for a soccer ball. So,
well, I would offer, and please correct me if you think I'm incorrect in the statement, but I would offer that if it's a school function that's there, there's going to be a school representative that would be able to have access in there. So it's not something that Solar City owns the key to, and they couldn't go in. So hence the two gates as well for access. It might be advantageous to maybe put one on that side for that purpose.
I take it the two gentlemen in the rear are from Oakwood.
Yes.
And I'd be curious to know, years ago in the summer, you used to rent out to various leagues and so forth for youth programs. And I don't know if you still do that or not. But that would not be an Oakwood function. That would be whoever's renting it. Is that still going on?
No, you're gonna have to come up and speak in the mic.
And introduce yourself, please.
Good evening, friends. I'm Peter Bailey. I'm the head of school. I'm in my 15th year as head at Oakwood Friends School. With me is Chad Chanfrani, our assistant head for operations and technology. He's been at the school for 10 years. He served for a number of years as a varsity soccer coach at Oakwood, currently serves as our ultimate frisbee coach, whose team we just lost to Poughkeepsie Day School. Onward. We're very, very cautious about the oversight of athletic events at the school. And it is true that at any interscholastic game, we have between 2 and 4 coaches at a minimum on site. We also have our school nurse in attendance at all athletic events in the event of any sort of injury or mishap. We also, of course, because of campus maintenance issues and because of campus liability issues, are very careful about campus rentals. And it is true that in the summer we occasionally do a rental for a like organization. So, for example, the soccer teams from Friends Seminary sometimes come up in late August for a week of preseason soccer camp because they don't have any fields in Manhattan that they can use. We've also rented the fields similarly for a preseason soccer camp to Marymount, which is a girls' Catholic school in Manhattan. But we always ensure that they have an appropriate number of coaches and other adult supervisors in residence to oversee the safety of the kids. And obviously, it's in our interest to make sure that the solar array is protected, just as it's in our interest to make sure that our students are protected.
Thank you.
You don't rent out any longer to like Town of Poughkeepsie or any. Years ago, when there wasn't enough fields, so
yeah.
That's about it.
Right.
Okay. I understand quite well the high school responsibilities for sports and the number of,
mm-hmm.
you have to have a trainer there or somebody, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera these days. Yeah. So, okay, as long as you can keep them from climbing the fence, I'd be happy about that. So, Solar City is strictly building this for Oakwood School.
Correct, yes.
You're not renting land and it's, you're producing an income from it. It's strictly for, you're basically building it for Oakwood, sold to Oakwood. And
well, we are selling, we're building the system, and we own the system, and we're selling the power to Oakwood.
So how are you paid for that?
We're paid through they're purchasing the power. It's called a power purchase agreement, PPA.
So you basically own the power.
We own the system. We own the maintenance on it. We take care of it for 20 years.
Except for cutting the grass.
Except for cutting
whatever.
The grass.
What's the average kVA per day that you produce in a facility that size, roughly?
It's a 600 kilowatt system. In the summertime, with 6 hours, probably 3,600 kilowatt hours.
Yeah.
That'd be pretty average day.
And the demand from Oakwood is like what?
700,000 kilowatt hours a year.
A year?
A year.
So certainly there's a lot of excess there.
No, because over a year, basically, the system can produce about 700,000 kilowatt hours for the whole year.
Okay. And that is basically sold back to the grid, I assume?
Well,
whatever excess there is?
Yeah, technically it goes to the grid. And there's a credit generated that, and that
right.
credit is applied to the accounts at the school.
I was trying to understand the need for still the line from Central Hudson coming down that line. I guess in the wintertime you got to make sure that you got line, right?
Right. Well,
right.
It's over the year it nets out. So there's actually more power produced by the array in the summertime.
Certainly.
When there's more sunshine, and then those credits are used. Yeah. And then you get a winter like we've had here, and you're not producing much at all. So, but over the course of a year, it nets out.
Okay. What is the distance between the soccer field and the fence? I couldn't make it out.
We're 20 feet from the soccer field to the bottom of the slope. So, and then we're another on this new the grading plan that you have. That it's slightly different than what we have here. And I don't know the exact, but just scaling it roughly, I think we're another 25 or 30 feet before we hit the fence on the side. So the fence is way up at the top here.
Mm-hmm.
The field is down here, so we have 20 feet from the edge of field to the edge of our site limits. And then we have approximately, if you look at the distance there, from here to here, I would say it's probably another 35 feet or so up to the array. So 55 feet, give or take.
Okay. And you also say on the print here, on the one I have, you're going to remove sections of the existing guardrail. Is that for during construction or?
Keep shutting it off. I should do that. Yeah, as Joe and I, it's not a safety guardrail.
Yeah.
It's an aesthetic guardrail. It's flat on both sides. Mm-hmm. It's just a wood post guardrail. I don't know exactly why or when it was installed, but we are going to take a section of it out towards the end. And the intent was, there was a question asked about why we didn't come in straight. I think your comp,
yeah.
The any large equipment would still back in even straight. They wouldn't have a place to turn around to unload, so they would pull up into their drive and back into this loading area. So that's somewhat of the angle. The other reason was the school itself didn't want to have the any open area as you pulled straight in to just see straight in and almost have to feel like, oh, I'm supposed to drive straight, and that's driving into the array. So they wanted to keep you onto the path the way it is today.
And last question is, what is a medium voltage transmission line?
Medium voltage, it's sort of a misnomer, but it's in the utilities. It's anything, I believe, of our 6,000 volts. So it's utility voltage. This is going to be 13,000 volts. So it's what you would, it's the utility side of your transformer.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Gotcha. I think I'm done for this round.
Well, I don't have any additional comments. What's the pleasure of the board?
Someplace here is
a recommendation. I move that the planning board declare its intent to be lead agency to coordinate the environmental review of the proposed project as an unlisted action and direct the department staff to notify the involved agencies of the board's intent by circulating a copy of this resolution, a copy of the Part 1 long form EAF, and a copy of the application to the identified involved agencies.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we declare our intent to be lead agents. I call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes 4-0. I move that the planning board defer action on the site plan application pending establishment of a lead agency and direct the applicant to respond to the following preliminary comments received from the town departments and agencies, including but not limited to those below, 1 through 8, plus the comments from the board and engineering and so forth presented today at the meeting.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we defer action on this site plan pending lead agency and so forth. I call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes 4-0. So I guess we'll see you again soon.
That you will. Thank you.
All right, thank
Richard,
you.
I assume, assuming we get a submittal for the May meeting, board has no objection to the staff determining to schedule a public hearing?
No.
Thank you.
And just to follow up, for Ed's comment, I assume you don't want the soccer balls coming in either to damage the array.
Correct.
Not just the kids looking for it.
Okay, the second item for plan reviews tonight, Balbo 78 Main Street site plan amendment to rebuild a demolished single-story retail space as a 583-foot square foot addition to a three-story building, 78 Main Street, zoned ATC, Arlington Town Center. Plus or minus 0.37 acres, type 2 action, Anthony Balboa and Maria Balboa owners.
Thank you. I think I already emailed these to you. These are all the comments and the recommendations.
Oh, great. Really? I didn't see this one.
Sorry. Oh well. That's why they paste.
Sorry.
introduce yourself and, you know, make any presentation you have.
I've been doing this long enough, I shouldn't be shocked by the length of these notes, but I'm impressed with the thoroughness of the effort of our government. I am Jordan Valdina, Synergy Design, Architecture, and Engineering, representing seven this application for this rebuilding of a single-story addition on the front of the building located at 788 Main Street, corner of Raymond Avenue and Main Street, Poughkeepsie. Okay. Getting my comments here in front of me. These comments I have not seen, but I'm sure we'll go over them. What would you like from me next? Should I describe this more, or?
If you don't have anything, the comments you want to make, I'll have Eric present the.
Do you have do you have your renderings to put up for the board to see?
I do not have a board to show what's on these plans.
So we may or may not be able to do architecture.
We may or may not. Right.
Do you have the plans?
No.
Not good enough,
plans.
Huh?
We just have elevations.
Let's
just see something.
No,
the
no.
The ones over there, but you won't want.
The board has the plans that you submitted, yes, which has the black and white elevations.
Okay. I can try to do a makeshift routine if it might be helpful.
Let's go through site plan, and then if we get through site plan, then we can talk about architectural
Carol.
Review.
Okay.
You get paid extra time.
Here, this one's in color.
Oh, I
feel awful.
What
did I do? Did I not give you color set? Mm-hmm.
Correct.
That's not right. My apologies.
You know, she gets extra pay for this. It's coming out of your pocket.
I didn't hear what you said, but I got that as coming out of my pocket, which I'd have to agree with you. I'm sure whatever
pay.
it is. Okay.
She gets easel duty pay. Right. We reviewed the application. It's pretty, as the board probably recalls, the plans in this went back and forth previously, and last October the board granted architectural approval for a facade as for the demolition, the portion of the building that remained after demolition. This application is now, the applicant has decided to, that they want to rebuild the one-story portion of the building. Thus, this is a new site plan application and would require a new architectural review and approval. We've generated some comments. Most of them have to do with details of the site plan. We need some more information on the plans. Most of it is for technical compliance. Didn't really have any great issues of substance. I understand the Zoning Board of Appeals did grant the area variances on Monday night. I haven't seen documentation of it yet, so I would leave that condition on there should the board choose to adopt our recommendation. I guess the only substantive question I think the board would be interested in are how many tenants will be in the building and whether the addition is intended to accommodate additional tenants or to serve the existing tenant space that's there. And then, of course, if the board has any other questions, then please ask them. Otherwise, we are recommending that the board waive the site plan public hearing and grant additional site plan approval.
Regarding tenants, it's my understanding that the presumption it would be a new tenant, meaning not part of the three-story portion of this building, the older portion that's not being touched, meaning not being changed besides the addition of this single-story space on the front. That would presumably contain its own tenant, for example, retail, like previously it was a Verizon store. So the exact number of people operating the operation would to be determined, but presumably looks sort of like a one, two, or can't imagine more than three employees in such a space.
So the proposal is for an additional, the proposed addition is 583 square feet.
Yes.
So this proposal represents the addition of another tenant for the building within a space of approximately 583 square feet?
Yes. Yeah.
Joe, do you have any comments?
Yeah, we had some, nothing too major, but it's just some few clarifications of the drawings. Looking for an additional plan view of the roof area to show a little closer detail on how the roof drainage works and if there's access to fire escapes on this portion of the roof. We asked for some details on water, existing water and sewer connections, and details on water meter and backflow prevention device.
Okay.
Oh, I'll also add regarding our comment number 10 about the New York State Department of Transportation.
Okay.
I had a conversation a couple days ago with Chuck Walter of the DOT, because their response was clearly ambiguous. And he did indicate that there is no permit required at this time, that their response was a boilerplate lead agency response, despite the fact that this was not a lead agency circulation, and that there is no permit anticipated according to the proposal.
Okay.
Oh, and also, want to add those dates?
Well, we can either do it now or later.
I would do that now.
Do it, okay. You want to go ahead?
Sure. In discussion with the board, we had put some blanks for the recommended dates of applicability for the conditional site plan approval, because they do want to see action taken on this building at the soonest possible time.
Right.
So the recommendation was to have construction to be started by July 16th of 2015, and to be completed by November 19th of 2015. And those dates were chosen in order to correspond with the Planning Board meeting schedule. Also that in comment number 11, that the period of site plan expiration be according to that time period. So only in 11D, only the first sentence would remain and the rest would be deleted. In other words, not to provide for extensions.
Mm-hmm.
We finished with our comments from the department?
That's it.
Carl, do you have any?
I guess I had a question about why there's that extra door that's kind of going out to the alleyway, because that's where cars drive in and out past versus the
Yeah. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to. Were you?
That's right.
More?
I was just asking about that doorway.
Yeah, I believe that the normal use would suggest a utility type of access. There's a striped way over there that currently, if somebody has a hand cart with, delivering, paper towels or something to Tony's Pizza or something, they walk up. Yeah. And so that lends itself to such an access, even though it's not officially designated only for that. That would be the idea, as opposed to the main public entrance.
Okay, delivery access. And it looks like it has no connectivity to the rest of the building inside, right?
The side? I'm sorry.
There's no doorway into the rest of the building.
Oh, it's correct.
Standalone.
As proposed, space. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'm anxious to see it move forward and get done as well. And some of my comments will be architectural when we get to that.
Understand. Yep.
Yep.
First of all, Carol, I hope the Price is Right isn't watching this tonight.
I know.
Is the proposed building going to be exact same footprint as the previous one? That was demolished
within inches of tolerance. Yeah, I wouldn't put my seal to the exact footprint, but certainly, yeah, very, very close.
So it's not going to be taking up any more
definitely
sidewalk
not
space or anything like
that.
That
it will not. Yeah.
Okay. That's it.
Ed, do you have any comments?
You know what the nature of the retail space is going to be used for? You have any idea on tenant?
No. Just because there's no prospective tenants that I'm aware of. Okay. Specific prospective tenants, yeah.
I'm just a little nervous about that door going out into that driveway. And it could be a delivery, you know, situation, but then it could block the driveway. It's like, yeah, I don't know. Mm-hmm. Eric, you got any problems with that?
We've had a lot of meetings with the building department on the fire escape and accessibility route, and both that door is located also next to where the fire escape ladder is proposed to come down.
Right.
And according, in consultation with the building department, among our conditions here, I think it's number 3, it needs to be a protected route in order to qualify fire access route. And so what we discussed with the department and the applicant was providing bollards that would protect it from vehicles. Effectively, I think that's going to eliminate it as a delivery access location, because beyond the bollards, if there's a truck, it's going to block access, and that driveway is an approved driveway for fire access for the Hurricane Grill, which is whose site plan encompasses a part of this. The parking plan includes a portion, the parking behind this site as well. It's not going to be permissible as a delivery parking area.
Oh, no, not a parking area. A pedestrian walking in with a box type of delivery is what I was referring to. Yeah. No, certainly no, not a loading berth. No, it's a drive. But the drive is not right as you step out the door. There is a space. So the bollard concept back there, that close to the street, it's a tough call design-wise. It almost represents an encumbrance physically.
Is the door necessary?
What? Do I think it's necessary? I'm sorry.
Is the door necessary on the alley?
I think
it's a fire code requirement for it?
No, there's not a fire code requirement for it, as far as I know.
Is there internal access from the back of the tenant space? Because the last application we had mm-hmm. included a floor plan that showed this as a part of the space internal to the building. It wasn't a separate space. So that's
now,
why
I
I'm asking
check
whether or
myself.
Not. That's okay. Why I'm asking whether or not the
yeah,
door
well,
is
let
necessary.
Let me make sure. In my recollection, I could be. I'm sorry. I would have to double check that. I wasn't. The reason that I would say that there wasn't is because I didn't think that I changed the plans. But the last time I touched these plans prior to doing this submitting, when he was thinking about, was a while ago. So. Before I say definitely, I'll double check, but I don't recall that there was an access between the new single story space and the rest of the existing building directly.
If anything, I think almost an access on the Main Street side might be a better place to have a door rather than over there. But I don't know what you're doing retail-wise or otherwise.
Right. My sense is it's a judgment call, and I know you're weighing it against a couple things. From the functionality of it, if you go back there, I'm sure you've probably been over there, but if you visit it again, there's a natural sort of utilitarian aspect to that back side. So there's probably the same guy who might deliver something to Tony's, just for example, and there's a pathway.
Well, at any
you
rate,
can go around the corner and go to Main Street. No one's going to pine away, but yeah.
At any rate, this thing has been an eyesore for a long time. Certainly would like to see this thing get done and
right.
get cleaned up and get on with it. We've been back and forth on this thing how many times? A lot. Okay. I think you got our message.
Absolutely.
All right.
Yep.
Do we have any other discussion from the board?
Ben, anything?
I mean, I guess I'm comfortable with having the department work out the door details and such if we go ahead.
Okay. You ready for a motion?
Yep.
Let's see.
Let's start off with the...
This one here.
The waiving of the...
Yeah. I move the planning board waive... site plan public hearing for this project in accordance with Town Code 210-151D.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the town, that we waive, the planning board waive the site plan hearing, public hearing for this project in accordance with Town Code 210-151D. Call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries 4-0.
Okay, I move the planning board grant conditional site plan approval for Balawa Bowl at 788 Main Street site plan, subject to the items listed below, except that it shall be void if construction is not started by 7/16 of 2015 and completed by 11/19 of 2015. And we'll include items 1 through 11, and we'll revise the zoning administrator's review to be had. And also, item D under 11, scratch out from prior to the expiration of the site, etc. The remaining sentence will read, this site plan approval shall expire after the valid period identified by adoption of this resolution.
And then we need to add architectural review.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's,
and then 12 is architectural review.
And 12 is architectural review.
Second.
Moved and seconded that the planning board grant conditional site plan approval for the Balbo 788 Main Street site plan, subject to the items listed below, except that it shall be void if the construction issuance of a building permit is not started by July 16, 2015, and completed with the issuance of a certificate of occupancy by November 19, 2015, subject to 1 through 11, or 1 through 12, 12 being architectural review, number 3, the zoning administrator's comments is modified to the zoning administrator's review, and D of 11, the site plan approval shall expire after the valid period identified by the adoption of this resolution. The remaining sentences in that thing are deleted. I call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 4-0.
Okay.
Now, do you want to discuss your picture for architectural review? And we are going to need some samples of the with colors, and they will have to be delivered to the planning department. What, the next week or?
Sure.
Within the next week.
This is another way of checking a microphone. It's with your voice, as opposed to tapping. The materials are actually the same as, but I'll explain a little bit, as the previous site plan submittal and for architectural review, which did not have this being rebuilt. So it's a stucco or an EIFS system with a beige color. I'm hoping that maybe those sample boards are still in existence and available. Okay, if so, they still apply. A standard aluminum frame, commercial windows, a brick base to match the motif of the more historic brick, if you will, but they can't help but looking a little more modern and clean, but it's a basic brick and a red brick-like color despite the appearance on this drawing with a little cap, a metal roof, and I will double-check that sample board to make sure the one thing that might be missing is something that indicating the metal roof. But everything else was the same. There currently is a beige type of stucco, but again, I have the specific colors to the side of this building on that drive side. And so you can actually see the color that will be matching here. And that's about all I can think to say at the moment. But I will double check. I think I would need to get you a metal roof sample.
Well, we're going to need the sample board. So if it doesn't exist, you're going to have to recreate one, okay, with the colors and so forth. And I don't know, what's the time?
When you say doesn't exist, you mean the one that I already submitted,
right,
is gone?
Well, I don't know.
We'll have to check.
See if it
should be
still
in our carefully maintained archives.
Yeah.
I mean, and if it is, fine.
Yeah. Okay.
But if not.
If we got it last time, I don't recall offhand. quite honestly. Let's check.
Can you say the color of the metal roof? Missed that.
Yeah, the color here is sort of the idea is that it's muted and in a direction of a beige, but being graying out a little bit. But I'll clarify that.
Okay,
I'll clarify the roof for you. That's the main thing.
Just wondering if it ties in at all with the existing roof up above somehow.
Yeah, I think the idea here. That's one good option. Another aspect sometimes of matching something. I'm speaking my own opinion regarding the aesthetics, of course. Is sometimes when you add a new on an existing, especially one that's a little older or quirky, sometimes you clearly, but in a way that marries well, provide something distinct, as opposed to try to match and it really never will. So like these bricks will look new, nice, and yet they speak to this. That'll be the idea with this roof. But you'll be the judge of that when I submit something. You know,
I'll tell you what, I'm going to leave this up to the department. I mean, do you want to accept it as this with him providing you, or do you want to wait and do architectural review?
If the board's comfortable having staff do it, that's fine. I had I provided four kind of comments on architectural, which you want to leave those to our discretion as well.
Yeah, I would.
So that there's
fine. In the interest of having this thing get going.
I'm
really a little ticked that you haven't come and brought this kind of information.
You're referring to me in the majestic sense. Well, so when I say I'll be...
I don't know who else to blame, because you're the only guy
I'm the only
I've
one
ever
here.
Seen come
that's
here.
The, that's the beauty of being
so
a messenger.
You are the messenger.
I am. And I got your motion before, too. I'll convey it.
Okay.
I understand.
So there's no other plans to do anything architectural with the existing building, just as far as the facade on the front?
Correct.
This addition.
Just the addition is going to be affected.
I'll tell you what. I will make a motion that the planning board grant conditional architectural review approval according to the renderings, which we haven't received, but review approval with the planning board or the
department
resolving the issues of the colors and materials and any outstanding questions that have come up, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Does that...
Eric, you can call me.
I will make sure. I think there might have been a color one submitted. If not, it's my fault. And again, I do apologize. Mm-hmm. And it would be my pleasure to submit this, certainly the sheet in color.
Yeah.
It is at least, even though it's not exact, at least it brings it to life a little bit in the mind to correlate with the sample.
Well, we
sample
just want you to work all this out with Eric.
Okay.
And the planning
department. What we have seen a number of times is that computer generated
exactly
stuff is not like what the actual stuff really looks like. So,
yeah, totally. We did a 3D rendering of this without this on this. This, as you can see, is 2D, and yet it's quasi-rendered. It's in color. And the beige, when rendered under the sunlight by the computer, printed in a sort of a faded olive.
Right.
I mean, it looked horrible and showed up with that. And so, yes. But hopefully we'll find that sample board.
To be honest, I don't. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I want to get this over.
Yeah.
Do I hear a second? Go on.
I trust Eric. Second.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded that we grant conditional architectural review subject to review with the planning department to resolve outstanding questions.
We all hold Eric responsible.
Right. I call the question. All those in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes 4-0. Move forward and...
All speed.
Okay?
Yes.
Jordan, when can you get those samples to be, or could you meet with me next week with the renderings and any samples you've got?
Yes. But the sample board hopefully might still be in your possession.
Well, okay.
Eric will check that.
We'll check.
Okay.
You're located on Neptune Road, is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. You're close. Close by, we can find you.
Oh, absolutely. I'm not usually there, but
send David after. Other business. Number one, Love Road Brownfield Remediation Land Contour Time Extension. Conditionally approved land contour permit for removal contaminated soil, port and landfill of clean soil required by brownfield program, 20 to 50 Love Road, Zone BH Highway Business, 4.6 acres, figure negative declaration adopted April 17th, 2014, Herbage Rental owner. Where is the, do I have a, pull that up, all that stuff.
That one?
I get it. Well, you got one that's much better than mine. The 90-day time extension is requested for April 17th.
Basically, planning department, I forwarded a, excuse me, an update from Frank Rettle that came in, I think, this morning, in which he explained what the situation is present with the DEC. They were supposed to have a meeting last week that the DEC postponed. In any case, he anticipates it's going to take a while to work things out with the DEC to determine whether or not he actually needs the land contour permit. And if he does, he'll have to do some testing to, you know, complete the conditions of approvals. Therefore, he's requesting a time extension of 1 year, and staff are in agreement with that proposal.
Okay, so the motion is that the planning board grant a time extension for conditional approved land contour permit for 1 year from April 17, 2015 forward to April 17, 2016.
Second.
We moved and seconded that we grant the time extension. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 4-0. And, number two, town board referral of zoning amendment to add 210-22 Main Street Drive-In Overlay District. We need a recommendation to the town board regarding the proposed amendment to the Arlington Town Center District to add a new overlay district and regulations.
Described by Neil.
Right. The town board, April 15, 2015, referred this matter to the planning board for advisory recommendation and scheduled a public hearing for May 20th, 2015 at 7 p.m. Staff recommends that the planning board convey a positive recommendation to the town board regarding the adoption of the proposed amendment, which was we received tonight.
So moved.
Second.
The moved and seconded that we grant, or that we forward a positive recommendation to the town board. I call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes 4-0. Do we have any further business? Move that the meeting be terminated. Moved and seconded, we terminate the meeting. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Meeting is terminated.
Turn the mic off.
Eric, your legacy.